political institutions and armed forces. Those are sources of power. But in a globalized world, where we live in the same village and where events in one corner of the world can quickly affect developments in another, you need the media to protect your interests. The global marketplace means that every nation must have a voice. And in Africa, we don't have voices. Our voices are weak. So developing the Nigerian media will give Africa a strong voice, will give Nigeria a strong voice. The West won the Cold War through their own media infrastructure. And Nigeria today is on the path to developing its own media. And as Minister, I would like to continue to cooperate in any way possible to strengthen the Nigerian media. But our image depends on what we do, you know, as politicians, as professionals, you know, as citizens. I do know that the media is a mirror, mirroring everything that happens to society, which is important for us. But at the same time, I believe that as professionals, we need to come to terms with certain objectives of our nation. We should report the nation to project it, to strengthen it, to enable it to overcome its difficulties. And when we come into times of crisis, we should report proactively to overcome crisis and to move the development of the country forward. That is why you see in the United States, I keep making the point, New York records the highest number of crimes in the world annually. Burglary, murders, and all that. But Americans will never describe their country as a criminal society. If you go to Johannesburg in South Africa, Lagos pales into insignificance in terms of the crimes that are committed in Johannesburg every week. Huge crimes, murders, robbery, everything you can count on. If you go to Cape Town and you see the number of assassinations, you will be shocked. But somehow, South Africans continue to project their nation as if it's the most peaceful country, you know, in the continent. I am not saying we should cover anything, but I'm saying we need to report Nigeria also with a positive tinge, such that our people can earn the respect. We can encourage the people, you know, to work on the things that are not working. But when we report from the point of view of running it down, then it's like a child. You say, "Oh, you are so dull. You are, you know." If there's always discouragement, then that child is unlikely to find the focus and develop. So I'm appealing to all of us, because especially in recent times where we have come under attack by anti-state groups, which is really unfortunate. We have suffered a number of losses. But sometimes, I'm not talking of punch in particular, but when you see some of the reports we read, often there is this sensitization and glorification of anti-state groups. And terror everywhere in the world is horror, is crime, is evil. And if all of us identify it that way, we will unite the country against it. But if you report it from the point of view of giving them a lot of glory, I've seen in some newspapers, people just text a message to the press and it is headline the following day. I mean, our journalism, there must be something that adds up to a strong source. We're making the same mistake the West did by glorifying Osama bin Laden to become a monster. Osama was sold to the world by the screen of CNN. It became so monstrous. And I think we should learn from those mistakes as far as distress are concerned. Also, sometimes when there are religious crises in Nigeria and ethno-religious crises, you can read some newspapers and know where they identify. If there's a problem between Christians and Muslims, you can read the newspaper and say, "This is for Muslims, this is for Christians." It happens so constantly, and I'm frightened by that kind of prospect, because the media must unify the country. It should report it, it should say what is wrong, it should say what is not working, but it should stand on the pedestal of national unity. Because our country's size is the hope for this continent. Our country's diversity is the strength for this continent. And that is why, in spite of everything, Nigeria remains the destination for most black people in the world. Because they are looking for a place as big as this that can speak for them in terms of global crisis, in terms of regional crisis. And this country will make it. There's absolutely no reason why we will not make it. So having said this, I will conclude my remarks by saying we have also come here to tell you that the democratic journey is going on. And the president sends his special greetings to the Punch and his management. And it's also to tell you that we have taken off on our transformation program. We are seeking the cooperation of the media to report the major development activities of the government. We know that in terms of stress, negative stories can easily come to the fore. I've told people that even in war, progress is going on. People are marrying. People are still going to the farm. And that is why they remain alive. In our own situation, we have floated our program, the transformation program, anchored on three parameters. The first one is to renew the nation's infrastructure. And we are doing so now, steadily. From 2012, we are going to be seeing a lot more progress on this flank. And in the area of infrastructure, we are targeting power supply, which is our number one goal. And I know as a media house, all of us keep crying. We run on generators. When will this power come? All of us in government, every day, we believe that is really our covenant to the people of Nigeria. We are working hard on power. Presently, we are renewing the entire transmission infrastructure. A lot of reforms are going on. The power roadmap is being implemented. We have segmented power now in such a way that we are asking private people to also generate power. We are privatizing transmission and generation as well. So far, the reforms have worked. The regulatory agency has been set up. The bulk trader has been set up to buy power from private generating companies and feed onto the transmission and onto the national grid. We are building 10 new power plants in the country. You know, work has been going on steadily. In the new year that we are going to enter, some of them will be commissioned. At Olorosogun here in Ogun State, the second, the phase two is virtually now ready. What we are doing there now is to connect it to gas supply and bring it on board. A lot of sugar phase one and two will give us close to 1,000 megawatts of electricity here in Ogun State. Sapele is virtually ready also, and we are hoping that as we enter into the new year, Sapele will also be commissioned. Now, a number of the gas-fired power plants have also reached advanced stages. In fact, most of them now are working to connect them to gas. In fact, presently we have the capacity to generate over 5,000 megawatts presently. That is gas supply to one or two plants that have delayed us, but we're working hard on it so that as we enter 2012, we will up the power supply situation in the country. Our hope, given what is going on, is that increasingly between 2012, 2013 and 2014, the electricity supply situation in the country is going to witness steady improvement. We hope eventually to target major cities like Lagos, like Port Harcourt, Kano, give them steady power supply, and then because these are the industrial giants, and then we can now gradually feed, you know, the rest of the country as we move along. Recently, we had a problem at Edin Power Plant. We were worried report that it had collapsed. It hasn't collapsed. What happened at Edin was that there is a treatment plant that supplies water to the cooling systems of the power plant. It developed a problem because we had a lot of trouble with the minister about 3 months, 2.5 months ago. I was there personally, and we saw Edin producing power at about 1,080 megawatts of electricity. It was the last unit which was already giving power to the store, so that it would produce about 1,280 megawatts of electricity. So the last unit is being restored, and the water treatment problem at the plant has been restored. 4 of the units are back to work, and we're about to restore the fifth one, as at yesterday when I spoke to the Minister of Power. So we are working hard in the power sector. The thing with power is that once you start, until you complete the project, even if it is 1% remaining, it can't give you electricity until you are ready. But this is being done. And I want to use the auspices of the Punch newspapers to appeal to Nigerians, you know, to follow up on this program and to reassure them that the president and all of us remain commitment and we remain loyal to our commitment to the stability of power in the country. We have also now finished the drawings for the Mambila hydroelectric power plant, which has been on the board since 1960s. We want to build it, and we hope that before the end of this administration, we should complete that power plant. It will give the nation about 2,600 megawatts of electricity. It's the icing on the cake. It will get it done, and we will get it done, because we're working in PPP, private partnership with the Chinese, to build the Mambila. We have also now completed plans to generate power from about 16 dams, existing dams that are already built. What you need to do is just get turbines and insert into them, and then transmit, generate power and transmit. We are going to use these dams for this purpose. So we remain steady, we remain committed on our power map, roadmap, and we call on the media to continue to report. Also go to where these factories are and report on progress that's going on. We discover that there isn't too much attention given to development now, and we're only reporting quarrels between big time politicians, you know. Chiroma speaks his headline, Obasanjo speaks his headline, Obangida speaks his headline, or Jonathan. I think we need to step back a little and also look at development, because ordinary people want to see what is indeed democracy for them, and a lot of things are happening. So we will crave your attention to do so. Now the other area that we are working at seriously in terms of infrastructure is the dredging of the Niger and the rehabilitation of the railways. On the dredging of the Niger, we have already finished the capital dredging of the Niger from the source up to Baro in Niger State. What we are doing presently is to do the maintenance dredging and keep the river channel clear of sedimentation. That is what is going on now. We're also building the inner water ports. That of Onitsha is ready for commissioning. And barges are already using the River Niger up to Lokoja conveying goods. So we're hoping that we'll stabilize this in the next one or so in 2012. And once we complete it, we will now start the dredging of the lower Niger from Lokoja up to Yola.